Good morning. Welcome to worship. We're so glad you're here on this Father's Day. Let's stand together. We're going to sing the hymn, Crown Him with Many Crowns.
His day. And that if you're a visitor with us today, our guest, thank you for being here. If you'll notice, there's a place on the bulletin on the back for you to fill out and tear out and place that in the offering plate as your gift to us other than your presence. We appreciate your cooperation with that. Let's pray together as we prepare our hearts to continue to worship the Lord today. Father, thank you for the privilege of allowing us to be here. Thank you for your work in our life. It pauses us just to stop and reflect upon your goodness. Lord, you are already crowned King of Kings, Lord of Lords. But today, let us crown you in each of our lives. We would truly crown you as the Lord of love, Lord of peace. We would understand who you are and how you want to work within our life. So let there be surrender in our life to your work today. Pray for your forgiveness upon our sins, Lord, that as you look and point out every offensive way within us, that you would lead us on the path of righteousness to which you have called us. So, Lord, we ask as you work in our life, that we, most of all, though, that we remember this time is for you. So let us praise your name in song. Let us present to you a heart that will work and is ready to respond to your leadings in our life. Lord, this is your time. Be glorified, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
He is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. That's the chorus of this song, Who You Say I Am. It may not be familiar to some of you, although we have sung this here before, but it's very easy to catch on. So let's stand together as we make this declaration.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me in, His love for me. Oh, His love for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God.
Thank you.
I think many times we forget where we were prior to a relationship with Jesus Christ. And this song shows us how separated we were from the Lord, how far we were from Him, and the fact that mercy came to us. We use the word mercy, we throw that out oftentimes in exchange with grace, and we think that mercy and grace are the same. We use them in that context. But mercy is us not getting what we deserve. Grace is us getting what we do not deserve. Mercy is when God looks at us and says, you deserve sin, you deserve death because of your sin. You deserve eternal separation from me in a place called hell. And then He sends His Son to die on the cross for our sins so that we can be saved. That's mercy. Mercy is when He looks at us and sees things in our life that He doesn't like, and yet He gives us another day and another opportunity to change those things. And I found that it is a beautiful picture, by the way, as we look at that, as we look at how God sees us and the mercy that He brings to us. But I've also found that we're not as quick to be merciful as we are to receive mercy from God. Today in Genesis chapter 45, we're going to look at the instance where Joseph offers mercy to his brothers. We've been journeying through this book, looking at the life of Joseph here in Genesis. And we know, of course, that Joseph sold into slavery by his brothers out of jealousy because he was the favored son of his father. We see that generational sin continuing to go, affecting another generation to the point that now Joseph is sold into slavery, where he ends up in Potiphar's house. And God was with him there, and Potiphar put him in charge of the entire house until the day that Miss Potiphar accused Joseph of trying to take advantage of her. And so Potiphar, who was the chief executioner, rather than killing Joseph because he didn't believe his wife in all probability, placed him in prison instead. And when the chief baker and chief cupbearer came in prison because Pharaoh was upset with them for a little bit, Joseph interpreted a dream for them and asked the one that was going to live, "Would you remember me when you stand before the king?" And he forgot him for 2 years. As we looked at last week, Joseph is brought from prison to interpret a dream for Pharaoh. And he tells Pharaoh about the 7 years of good that are about to occur, followed by the 7 years of famine. And he tells him the plan that needs to take place. He needs to take from the people and store up the excess so they will have a way to live. And Joseph says, "Well, I need to find somebody wise who will take care of this for me." And finally, he appoints Joseph to this position. And then in the chapters that we skip, Joseph, his word from the Lord came true, as they always do. And Joseph is taken care of, and all of Egypt's taken care of, but the people in surrounding areas are starving to death, including Joseph's brothers. And they come before Joseph. They don't know that it's Joseph, don't recognize him, because they are ready. They need something to eat. And Joseph sees them, and he's concerned about his father, and he wants all of his brothers there. And so he puts a test in to see if they're going to be honest. And now he's ready to reveal himself to them. They've come back. All the brothers are there in Genesis 45, verse 1. Then Joseph could no longer control himself before his attendants, and he cried out, "Have everyone leave my presence." So there was no one with Joseph when he made himself known to his brothers. And he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard him, and Pharaoh's household heard about it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still living?" But his brothers were not able to answer him because they were terrified at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come close to me." And when they had done so, he said, "I am your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now there's been famine in the land, and for the next 5 years there will be no plowing and reaping. But God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by great deliverance. So then it was not you who sent me here, but God. He made me father to Pharaoh, lord of his entire household and ruler of all Egypt. Now hurry back to my father and say to him, 'This is what your son Joseph says. God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, don't delay. You shall live in the region of Goshen and be near me, you, your children and your grandchildren, your flocks and herds and all you have. I will provide for you there because 5 years of famine are still to come. Otherwise, you and your household and all who belong to you will become destitute. You can see for yourselves, and so can my brother Benjamin, that it is really I who am speaking to you. Tell my father about all the honor accorded me in Egypt and about everything you have seen, and bring my father down here quickly. Then he threw his arms around his brother Benjamin and wept. And Benjamin embraced him, weeping. And he kissed all of his brothers and wept over them. Afterwards, his brother talked with him. Simon Wiesenthal lost 89 relatives in Hitler's death camps. He told of an experience he had while he himself was in a concentration camp as a prisoner. At one particular day, he was taken off his work detail. He was taken up some stairs into a dark room. That he walked in, there was a man laying in this makeshift hospital room in this bed who was bandaged from head to toe. He was a badly wounded German soldier. His name was Carl. And with a trembling voice, he began to make a confession to Wiesenthal. He told him how he had been brought up in a Nazi family, how he had fought, been taught to fight from the Russian front. He told about the brutal measures that his units had taken against the Jews. But there was one terrible atrocity that he was burdened with that day. That all the Jews in his town were herded into a wooden building. The door was closed, it was latched, and that building was set on fire. And Carl had taken an active part in that crime. Several times as Carl began to talk about details of things he had been involved in, Wiesenthal would turn to leave the room, but that wrapped hand would reach out and ask him to please, would you please stay? And this conversation went on for 2 hours. And finally, Carl told Wiesenthal why he had been summoned. He said, "Sir, I asked my nurse if there were any Jews who still existed. And if so, he wanted one brought to his room so he could clear his conscience. And this is what he said. I'm left here with my guilt. I do not know who you are. I only know that you're a Jew, and that's enough. I know what I'm asking is almost too much for you. But without your answer, I cannot die in peace." And Carl asked for forgiveness for all the Jews that he had killed. He asked forgiveness from a man who soon might would die himself. And Simon Wiesenthal sat in silence for a moment. He stared at the man's bandaged face. And at last, without saying a word, he stood up and he left the room. And he left that soldier in torment, unforgiven. End of the story is that Simon Wiesenthal seemed dissatisfied with his action. He went over it with his companions. He visited the dead soldier's mother. Eventually, he wrote a book where he asked 32 rabbis, Christian theologians, and secular philosophers to answer his question, "What would you have done?" Of the 32 people that he asked, the majority said he had done the right thing by leaving the soldier unforgiven. Matter of fact, of the 32, only 6 told him he had done wrong. And let's be honest, if we put ourselves there today and think, you know what, I don't know what I would have done. Probably all of us would have a hard time saying we could look at the man and say, "Yes, sir, I forgive you for your actions." But you have Carl's in your life. You have people in your life that may not have killed family members, or may not have killed anyone at all. They may not have done anything the way as this man did, but they have brought damage into your life. They've hurt you. The pain is real. For some of you, it may be more fresh than others. For some, there's a scab over it that you often pull away and go back and relive those moments. But bottom line is, you have never forgiven somebody for something they did to you. You're just like Simon Wiesenthal. And the Bible tells us that as believers, we have the responsibility and expectation from God to forgive those who have wronged us. More than the responsibility, we have the privilege of forgiving those who have done wrong to us. And so I could easily conclude today that if we look at that story and go, you know what, I would never be able to forgive Carl. Or I can never forgive that person who's hurt me, that's on the forefront of your mind, on the tip of your tongue today. If we had that attitude, then I don't think you understand the mercy of God. Even conclude that maybe you've never experienced salvation yourself and never experienced salvation yourself. Because the Bible is clear that when we have been wronged, as people who have been changed by the grace of God, experienced the grace, the mercy, the forgiveness of God, that we are to be people who give out mercy and grace and forgiveness. And when we're not, there is a heart issue in our life, a major heart issue that we need to address. The story of Joseph is a model of forgiveness. That as we see here, his willingness to stand up and to demonstrate compassion and mercy and grace to his brothers is something that we don't see often in our world, yet we're called to do the same. We're called to live such a life that if that person who's on the forefront of our mind, on the tip of our tongue today, that you may even be looking at in this room as you look around, that as their mind, as they come to mind, and the hurt they cause come to mind, that you and I are supposed to be able to look at them and to offer them the same forgiveness that Jesus offers us. Unconditional. No strings attached. And freeing both for them and for us. See, we have to understand that when you belong to Jesus, you belong to love. And when you belong to Jesus and you belong to love, you belong to forgiveness. So many times we have emotional stress that comes in our life, and the causes of a lot of our emotional stress is the fact that we do not give forgiveness and even receive forgiveness for the wrongs that we have done. So I want us to look today at Joseph's forgiveness and see how you and I can live such a life as Joseph lived, of being willing to forgive as we have been forgiven. Matter of fact, Jesus taught us to pray that way, didn't he? Forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. Could it be that many times our prayers don't seem to rise above the ceiling? It's because we have a place of unforgiveness in our heart. The Lord would teach us, as Peter asked him, Lord, how many times are we supposed to give someone? Up to seven times? See, the law required you forgive someone three times. Peter thought he was being real merciful here, and the Lord said, no, 77, or 70 times 7, whichever translation you have. You can't settle on either one, but the point is not the number. The point is that we don't get to keep score, that we don't get to check. You know what? I've forgiven you so many times, I'm not going to do it again. So what do we do? How do we live to overcome our flesh to live a life of constant forgiveness? Well, first of all, notice that Joseph does not respond publicly. Verse 1, when he no longer could control himself before his attendants, he cried out, have everyone leave my presence. Now, most of us, if we're honest, in Joseph's shoes, would have liked to have had an audience there, wouldn't we? And when those brothers standing before us who don't have a clue that that's who we are, we would have been able to plan, knowing that they're coming back. When they come back, they're getting a tongue lashing. When they come back, I can't wait to tell them everything I have to tell them. And if the redneck really starts coming out in us, we go, well, when they come back, I'm just going to lay hands on those boys. I'm going to teach them a lesson. They won't sell anybody else into slavery. And then in Joseph's position, one word, he could have turned around and told somebody, kill every one of them. And with that word, their lives would have ended. But Joseph is not at that. Why would that be our actions, though? Why do we often act that way? Why do we make a spectacle? Why do we want to see, want others to see us blow up and act in foolish ways? Well, the reason is because Scripture is clear that of man's heart come evil thoughts, greed, malice, envy, deceit, arrogance, slander, and folly. Listen to me, that's who we are when we allow the flesh to take over our lives. It's not pretty who we are when we're not living under the control of the Holy Spirit. Joseph had a golden opportunity. from the first moment he saw his brothers to do whatever he desired of them or with them. He could have played a cat and mouse game and tortured them. He could have ridiculed them all day long. But when he decided to reveal himself to his brothers, he cleared the room of everyone but them. See, Joseph had always had an entourage in the position that he was in. And so he tells them to leave. And now his 11 brothers are standing before him, and they're probably thinking, what now? What am I going to do now? What's he going to do to us? And when there was no one with Joseph, he made his presence known to his brothers. Now again, we like to have an audience. We like to have support. So we get people that support us already, who are looking out for our well-being, and they may even know the wrong that's been done to us, and they're trailing along, and they're back there giving us the, come on, you got this, let them have it. And we just spew out information, don't we? Or a lot of times, untrue information. And we love to let people have it. And then in today's world, we can really be a coward with that. We don't even have to look at the person. We can go on social media and we can post something. And we can be passive aggressive and not even have to post the person's name and talk about, you know who you are. And we can be big and bad behind that screen, can't we? And we will never be a person of forgiveness as long as we act that way. Think about it. Since Joseph wasn't going to punish his brothers, what's all the fuss about nobody watching? I mean, even when he's going to extend mercy and grace to them, why didn't he say, hey guys, y'all going to want to see this. These are my brothers. They sold me into slavery. And I'm here because of them. And I was forgotten for 2 years in the dungeon because they sold me in the first place. And Miss Potiphar's wife also accused me because these guys sold me in the first place. And by the way, boys, I was daddy's favorite. And he could have relived everything right then. And then offered grace. Why act the way he had? I mean, everybody would have had the warm fuzzies. It would have been such a glorious moment, right? You know why he cleared the room? It was nobody else's business. That's why. None of those guys with him that followed him around all the time, none of those guys that probably were glad to be in the presence of Joseph that day, none of them had been wrong. It was none of their business. And so he got them out of the room. They would have faced ridicule from the audience, even when he reacted the way he did. There's a great deal of wisdom in that move, by the way. When someone has wronged you, the last thing you should do is broadcast that everywhere. George isn't here, but that would have been a great place for an amen, by the way. Y'all are sitting there like, well, you know what? Unless somebody is at harm, there is no need for you to confront an individual in public. If you confront them publicly, or you go around telling others what somebody has done to you, you are only making matters worse. So how did Jesus teach the disciples? Matthew chapter 18, they talked about sin in the church and how to address that. He told them, when a brother sins against you, you go to them privately. That means you don't respond publicly. You go to that person and you share the wrong that's been done. And you deal with that matter there. And if they don't respond to you, then you take someone else with you. And then if they don't, then you treat them as someone who's never experienced the grace of God. Now, every time I've been interviewed, including when I interviewed here, I was asked here, how do you handle when you have conflict with an individual? And this is the scriptural way, Matthew 18. I shared that in that room, sitting over here in the parlor with those group of folks at that time. But you know what I found out? Is we want people to respond that way, but yet we don't want to respond that way ourselves. We know what Matthew 18 says. And we love to throw that out and tell people, this is how you're supposed to respond, right here. But yet, oftentimes when we're wrong, we love to broadcast it. Joseph teaches us that if we're going to offer the type of forgiveness that glorifies God, we do not respond publicly. So the next time you're tempted to blow up or to talk about somebody, I've shared this acrostic with you before. The next time you need to think, T-H-I-N-K, is it truthful? If it's not truthful, you have no reason opening your mouth in the first place. Is it helpful? Is it inspiring? Is it necessary? And is it kind? Now, I found that if we will ask ourselves those five things before we speak, many times we won't ever speak. And it'll save a whole lot of difficulty that happens down the road. We don't respond publicly. So many times that means we keep our mouth shut to others and we deal with the one who's wronged us. That was Joseph. But there's a second characteristic. He did not excuse their behavior. And I think that's important for us. Joseph isn't looking at them going, oh boys, it's okay. But catch, he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard him. And Pharaoh's household heard about it. And so there's a lot happening, a lot of emotion, I imagine, in those couple of verses. As the brothers stand there worried, suddenly this Egyptian official you just found out is your brother breaks out in tears. Not just silent tears, but tears seeping down his cheeks. With his outburst so great that those outside the room heard it and began telling others in Pharaoh's household what was happening. And all they knew is that something's wrong with Joseph in there. If you could hear him weeping. Now, this wasn't the first time that Joseph had wept. Not the first time he had showed emotion. But the other times he left the room. The other times he pretended everything was fine when it was not. But the emotions of having his brother in front of him and remembering their actions was too much for him. And he burst out in tears, but it did not excuse their behavior. And some pretty astonishing words quickly followed because he reveals himself, I am Joseph, and the next question, is my father still living? That's where his concern was. But he's so moved by this. And the hurt is coming back up at that moment. That at any time he could have allowed the family sins to come back up. And he could have shown some hatred and some deceit. And he pointed out what happened. I mean, he told them there in verse 4, I'm your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. He's not making excuses for them, but he didn't suppress or bottle up his feelings. He let them out in a very healthy manner. See, when we bottle up our emotions, eventually we're going to blow up. God created us as emotional people. We cannot deny that. But if you're trying to act one way while feeling another way, you're being emotionally dishonest. If somebody did something that hurt you, it made you angry, there's nothing wrong with you telling them what they did. Being angry is not a sin. The Bible says, in your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry. So the Bible tells us it's okay to be angry, but it's not okay to stay angry. How do we avoid staying angry? By letting our emotions out rather than bottling them up. We don't do that publicly. But again, we're willing to confront the issue that has brought the damage and the hurt in our life. It's Father's Day, so ladies, we're going to pick on you today because we need a break. Men, you do something wrong. I'm going to say you because it doesn't happen at my house. But you do something wrong. I can't do that. We do something wrong, but we're not sure exactly what it is. We just know, and so we go, what's the matter? Nothing. Right? Nothing. No, something's bothering you. What's the matter? Nothing. okay, I know nothing is wrong. Let's just go on about our happy business. Now, that's something all of us are guilty of. Ladies more than men, but something we're all guilty of. Where we try to pretend that nothing's wrong when there's something wrong. Joseph shows us that there comes a time in life where we have to quit excusing someone's behavior, quit pretending like things are okay, and tell them you have done wrong. See, confronting others with truth is not judgmental. Our society tells us that it is, but it's not. In fact, it can be the most loving thing that you can do. Just ask David. Remember, David is confronted by Nathan after his sin with Bathsheba. David thinks he's got away with it. Not just that he's committed adultery with Bathsheba, but he's had her husband killed. And he thinks, nobody knows this. And Nathan comes and points out his behavior, not in a judgmental way, but to tell him, you've done wrong. And you need to have people like that in your life. You need to be open to people telling you areas of your life where you've done wrong. And then correcting those areas, not getting mad about those things. See, we have to get to the point in our life when we quit excusing behavior. That when we see sin, especially sin that affects the body of Christ, which ultimately every sin does, but when we see those sins, there needs to be the time that someone points those out to us and can stop that and have that conversation with us, and that we quit seeing that sin and go, well, you know what? That's just who they are. You know, I don't think there's anybody named Smith here today. They're just a Smith. You know, all the Smiths, they're like that. Always been that way. His great-grandfather was like that. His great-great-grandfather. You're not going to change them. No. That may be the case, that we have generational sin happen in our life. But there must come a time when we quit excusing that behavior and go, you know what? I have a wrong in my life, and not everything is okay. And it's brought hurt to others. And if we're the conduit that God brings that about, we don't do it publicly, but we have to quit excusing someone's behavior and point out the sin, which can be one of the most loving things you can do. Thirdly, Joseph maintained a spirit of humility. We've talked about this throughout this journey of looking at his life. Even as he stood before Pharaoh and he's like, okay, I need a man who is wise enough to initiate this plan. And Joseph never volunteers for it, even though he was the one that came up with the plan of saving everyone. And now he stands before his brothers. These are common men except for Joseph. He had power. He had prestige. You didn't come into his presence without being invited. And notice he tells them in verse 4, come close to me. Come close. This is not just a spatial proximity, but he's inviting them into an intimate closeness. A word is used for coming near to someone for the purpose of embracing or kissing them. Come here, come close. He reveals himself. And then he tells them in verse 5, do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. Most of us, again, at that moment would have lashed out at them, demanded things from them, told them things like, you know what, you just think you know what a humiliation is? Wait till I finish with you. Or you've left me here all these years. Now it's your turn to pay the way that I have paid. But do you notice that nowhere here does Joseph recount the past? Nowhere here does he talk about what's happened to him? Nowhere even does he list his accomplishments? When he does list his position in verse 8, it's simply in a quick reference so that they will know what he's about to offer them is real. This humility that's there. And then in verse 14 and 15, he throws his arms around Benjamin, his true, whole-blooded brother, and they embrace each other. There's weeping. And then he kissed all of his brothers, and he wept over them. And did you catch the end of verse 15? Afterward, his brothers talked with him. They've got about 25 years worth of catching up to do. Brothers have families. He's got nieces and nephews he's never met. Things have happened in both everybody's life, all 12 of them's life over the last 25 years. They've got a lot of talking to do. And I imagine that every time they went back, I'm pretty confident of that, every time they went back to bring up the past and they referenced their wrongs, that Joseph stopped them. So, that's in the past. We're focused on the here and now. And they spent time together. Only somebody with a spirit of humility will spend time with someone who's wronged them. Only somebody with a spirit of humility even wants to be near, let alone with an intimate closeness with somebody who's brought harm to their life. Once upon a time, the story is told of a frog that lived up north and wanted to go to the south for the winter. Just like the geese and the ducks did every year, he watched them leave, and as he sat there and shivered in the snow and in the cold. So one year he got an idea. He went to the geese and he asked them, "Can I go with you?" Well, they laughed and said, "You can't fly." "I know," the frog said, "but I have a wonderful idea. Let me get a stick, and if the two of you will help me, I can go with you. If two of you would just hold an end of the stick in your beaks, I'll hang on to the middle of the stick and I'll get out of this miserable cold weather." And so two of them agreed for this to happen, and it worked beautifully for many miles. And then finally they got over the farmlands, probably the Mississippi Delta somewhere. A farmer looked up and saw this frog flying, holding on to a stick. He said, "Look at that," to a friend. "That's amazing. I wonder whose idea that was." And then the frog, quite proud of his accomplishments, opened his mouth to tell him. And he fell to his death. How often are we like the frog? Pride and self-righteousness are some of the most dangerous places for a Christian to live. And oftentimes I want you to think back to when there's conflict in your life, there's hurt in your life, that you use the word "my" or "I." That's my area. That was my life. That was my work. That was my family. And we open our mouths and we're affected spiritually. See, attitude is so crucial in the life of a Christian. We can go through the Sunday motions, by the way. We can carry out religious exercises. We can pack a Bible under our arms. We can sing songs from memory. And yet we can still hold grudges against the people who have wronged us. And in our way, we'll get even with them. We'll get back at them. But that's not God's way. Instead, Joseph shows us someone who was supportive and merciful and gracious and generous and unselfish, giving them an offer they can't refuse there, verses 10 through 13. "Why don't you come and live here? And I'm going to provide for you here," in verse 11, "because 5 years of famine are still to come. Otherwise, you're going to be destitute." Huh, wonder what we do. And we know the end of the story. They go back and they get their father, and they do come back and they settle in the land, and they're able to thrive because Joseph maintained a spirit of humility. And in that humility, brought them back and provided for them just like he was provided for himself. How did he do that? How could he have those first three things that we see here? I think it's because of the perspective that he had, and it's the fourth characteristic, that he maintained a divine perspective. Verse 7 and verse 8 have two words that change the story. The words, "but God." But God. "But God sent me ahead of you. You planned evil, but God sent me ahead of you. So it wasn't you who sent me here, but it was God." Joseph was a man who lived his life with a continual perspective, with a continual divine perspective. He could not have spoken such words of reassurance if he had not truly forgiven his brothers. For you can't truly embrace a person that you have not fully forgiven. Joseph didn't see his brothers as enemies because his perspective had changed. Years later, Joseph would say this again after his dad died, and his brothers were worried that since dad died, now he'll get even with us. And guilt is clinging to the side of the boat, clawing for a foothold long after grace has come on board and begun to steer the boat. And Joseph reminds them once again that he will forgive because he had a divine perspective. Most of you at one time or another have been treated bad by somebody. And when that happens, your perspective gets cloudy. You remember the manipulation? You remember the wrong? You remember the lies? You remember the unfair treatment? You remember the rejection? Evil was done to you, and it was meant to be evil. And what Joseph's brothers did to him, they meant for it to be evil, but God meant it for good. We have to understand that God's grace is greater than any hurt in your life. And when you understand that, it will change your perspective on your hurt. See, until you quit faulting those who hurt you and focus on the Lord's grace in your life, you will never experience the joy of the Lord. And so you think back to that divorce that you went through. Maybe you went through it as a child with your parents, and it brings back that hurt. Or that spouse who walked out on you. That parent that left. That boss that you feel like didn't do you right. That school teacher that picked on you. That sibling who was, you believed, the favorite. Or maybe it's the person who took advantage of you. Or the person who took your innocence. Until you quit living your life blaming them for everything, you will never be able to be spiritually effective the way that God intends. You have to offer forgiveness. And today I conclude that if you are unwilling to offer forgiveness, your heart is far, far away from God. That if these things you shake your head at, you growl at and think that can never happen, you don't know how hurt I've been. You don't know what's happened to me. You don't know how many times and every other excuse that we throw out there. When we're unwilling to forgive, our hearts have never been changed by the God that would forgive you of every wrong in your life. Several years ago, a man showed up at a church service. Someone pointed him out to me. I knew him as a man who drove a garbage truck for the county as his retired job, just as something to have something to do. His mother grew up in our church, and as often happens in small towns, you learn the whole family lineage as you find out about this person. Visited with this person in his house, who wasn't very welcoming. He showed up at church probably two or three times over two or three years. Then I heard that he was in the VA hospital, being diagnosed with cancer, was very little hope given to him. So I went to visit him in the hospital, and the welcome I got there was about like I got at his house. Drive 100 miles one way to get to the hospital, and you're in the room about 2 minutes. Okay, then. About a week later, he calls me. "Preacher, I am," and I can't remember his name today. I told him, knew who he was. "I need you to come see me, okay? And I want you to bring somebody with you." Well, that's usually a good sign that things aren't going to go well. You got to have backup. So I got somebody to go with me. Went to this man's house. His wife left the room. And I'll never forget the conversation he started. He said, "Preacher, I would come into church just a few times. I would sit there, and I just remain angry. So when my mama died, the church fed my family. And my grandkids wanted to go back for another piece of chicken, and there wasn't any left. And I've been mad for over 30 years over chicken. He looked at me and said, but I'm dying. Yes, sir. And I thought nobody cared at that church until you showed up in my hospital room. And I want you to forgive me on behalf of the church. And I want you to bring somebody so that they can tell others that have been there a long time like them that I was wrong. And I want them to forgive me for the way I've acted and the way I've talked about that church, the way I would think as I came and sat in the service. That was a Saturday night, I believe. Sunday morning, the man sat in church. And until for about the next month, he was there until his health wouldn't allow him. And then he died. And I met his family. And there was a history of the same kind of relationships. But they had changed about the last month of his life because he finally became a man of forgiveness. Those people are all in our lives, in our churches. They're at work, they're at school, they're everywhere you're going to go. And there's a world watching to see how we're going to act when we're wronged. That's why Jesus said, by this all men will know that you're my disciples, if you love one another. And true love requires that we be people of forgiveness. Today, some of you are like that man that called me. You've carried a grudge around for years. It may be over something as petty as chicken that ran out after everybody had eaten. It may be something that, again, the scar and the pain are real and they're there. And wherever it is on the spectrum, it doesn't change the fact that you're called to be a person of forgiveness. And so today, that's your responsibility, that's your calling, and that's my challenge to you, is for you to be such a person. And that may mean in just a second, as we begin our invitation, that before we even begin to sing, that you need to get up and leave because there's somebody that's not here that you need to forgive. And you need to get up and make a phone call or go see somebody. It very well could be there's somebody in this room that you've never forgiven for something they've done to you. And you need to move on that today. And both of you know it. And you probably are sitting on opposite sides of the place. Are you going to do anything about it? And then some of you, again, it's a foreign concept. You're like Simon Westenthal. You just want to get up and leave the room. You can't offer forgiveness because you've never been changed by the forgiveness of our Lord. And today you need to admit that to him, that you're a sinner in need of his forgiveness, in need of his grace, and believing that he died on the cross for your sins and he rose 3 days later. You place your faith in him and make him the Savior and the Lord of your life. And then you become a person of forgiveness. It's time for that generational sin that we talked about weeks ago that's affected Joseph. It's time for some of that to stop in some lives today. Would we be obedient to the call of God on our life? Let's pray together. Holy Father, your word is a sword. It cuts. It's tough to hear. It's tough to deliver at times. Today is one of those, because the responsibility of hearing it is great. For we now have responsibilities to offer forgiveness. Let that begin in this place, dear Jesus. Would you begin to change hearts, restore relationships, Let grace and mercy flow freely. Lord, what you're asking us to do is hard. It's tough. So give us your power, your strength to be obedient. Be glorified, Lord, in our response to your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand together? We're going to sing. This altar's open. Maybe you need to pray about what God has spoken to you about today. We'll be here to receive you if you need someone to speak to. Let us be obedient to the call of God upon our life.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who
truly are hungry for you. Father, we thank you for your mercy and your grace. Lord, may we be a people that walk in that by showing that to all those that we come in contact with. Father, we pray that you'll continue to work in our hearts. Lord, that you would show us maybe those folks that maybe we need to offer the same kind of forgiveness, the same kind of mercy that Joseph did. Father, we love you and we ask that you take these tithes and these offerings, use them for your kingdom in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Well, as always, it's an honor to worship with you today. Thank you for making that choice to be with us today. I hope you have a great rest of the day. No evening services or any activities today, so you get to enjoy the time together with your family, hopefully, and look forward to being back with you Wednesday evening, the next opportunity that we have to do so. Know what's happening in your bulletin, and opportunities to be together, to worship together, and serve together. I have to tell you, thank you for last week. Those of you that brought food last week and brought a lot of food, thank you very much for your help there. Had a great VBS family day. And we are gearing up now. Next week, we'll start our first Mission Yazoo. And then shortly after that is camp season and another Mission Yazoo. And then eventually the summer will be over and the short opportunity that we have to minister here. So many of you have mentioned, John was saying about camp, that you want your kids to go or your kids' friends to go along with them. And the deadline is passed, and that's usually when people sign up. So if that's the case, you need to get with him or your kid won't have a T-shirt. They can still go. But those are some things that have to be taken care of. So if you will do that, it'd be greatly appreciated. Look forward to seeing what God continues to do as we seek to follow him and be obedient to him in our life, individually and in our life as a church. Let's stand together and we'll sing as we are dismissed today.
May our homes be filled with dancing. May our streets be filled with joy. May injustice bow to Jesus as the people turn to pray from the rise to you from the